Hello friends, this is the first part of AS2. In this part, we will cover the concepts and PM questions.
Hello friends, I hope you and your families are doing good. I am Priyanka Purohit from Sharda Samriddhi Guidance SSG. I am also a CA final student preparing for May 21 exams like you all. So as you know, ICAI has announced the dates. It's 5th of July. The proper schedule will be announced soon. So we have to buck up and prepare for it in the best possible manner. So today we are going to start with Accounting Standard 2, Valuation of Inventories. In this video, we will cover the concepts as well as the questions from PM as well as SM. So let's start it. First of all, we will look into the definition of assets held. So what are inventories as assets held? It can be of three categories: for sale in ordinary course of business, in the process of production, that is a WIP for such sale, and in the form of material or supplies to be consumed in the production process or in rendering of services. So this is the definition we have to quote in case AS2 question arises in exam. We have to mention the inventories as held as assets, whether for sale in ordinary course of business, whether used in process of production, whether it is in form of materials or supplies to be consumed either in production process or in rendering of services. Now we will look into the further categorization based on this chart. Inventories are categorized into three categories. This is the finished products, that is finished goods, work in progress, and raw material. So raw material will be valued at cost if finished goods are sold at or above cost, otherwise at replacement cost. That means if you are selling the finished goods at or above cost, that is either you are making no profit or no loss, or you are making profit in case of finished goods, then you have to value raw materials at cost. If you are making loss in finished product, that is you are selling below the cost, then you have to value raw materials at replacement cost. The next one is work in progress. It is also similar like we are treating for the raw material. At cost, if finished goods are sold at or above cost, that is either at no profit or at profit, then we have to value work in progress at cost, otherwise it must be valued at replacement cost. Also, we know valuation of fixed goods is based on the policy of whichever is lower, cost or NRV, whichever is lower. So here cost, what is included in cost? Cost comprises of cost of purchase of that particular item, then cost of conversion is added to it, and any other cost is also added. This all three together makes the cost. And what is net realizable value? Net realizable value is realizable value less any selling expenses, if any. You will be able to understand it in a better manner in when we will solve the questions. Now let us look into the discussion on what is included in the cost of purchase, cost of conversion, and other cost. That is, all these three together would constitute the cost. Cost of purchase include purchase price plus expenses directly attributable, any expense which is directly attributable to purchase, like the taxes and duties, carriage inward, loading and unloading, excluding expenses recoverable from supplier. So if any expense is recoverable from the supplier, we have to subtract it, we have to ignore it, and we have to exclude it while calculating the cost of purchase. Similarly, these were the things which were included in the cost of purchase. Now we will look into which are the costs which we have to exclude from the cost of purchase. One was the expenses recoverable from the supplier, and other two are taxes and duties, if subsequently recoverable by the enterprise from taxing authority. So any expense which is recoverable either from the supplier or from the taxing authority, we have to exclude it. Example, duty drawback, sen VAT or VAT. Similarly, trade discount and rebates which are given to us by the supplier, this we have to exclude from the cost of purchase. Now we will look into the conversion cost. What is conversion cost? So conversion cost can be categorized into mainly three categories. The first one is the factory overhead, then second one is direct labor, and the third one is joint cost. So factory overhead, we will first look into factory overhead. It can be further bifurcated into fixed factory overhead and variable factory overhead. So when we are valuing fixed factory overhead, we have to consider and look into two capacities. That is, first one is the normal capacity and the other one is the actual production. Normal capacity, when we have to consider normal capacity, when actual production is almost equal to or lower than the normal capacity. So whenever actual and normal capacity is equal or almost equal, or it is actual production is lower, is less than the normal capacity, then we have to value using the normal capacity. So when we have to value at the actual production, when the actual production is higher than the normal capacity. So we have to remember that only if actual production is higher than normal capacity, then we have to consider the actual production. Otherwise, we have to calculate the fixed overhead on the basis of normal capacity. That is, when normal capacity is equal to actual production or it is lower, then the actual production is lower than the normal capacity. You will gain the better understanding of this concept when we will solve the questions. Similarly, in case of variable factory overhead, we have to always consider it at the actual capacity. So variable overhead will always be computed on the basis of actual capacity. Now we will move direct labor is there is nothing much to explain about it. Then we will move forward to the joint cost. Joint cost is required for joint products as well as byproducts. So joint products are manufacturing of two or more products together, and byproduct is any product which is not specifically produced, but it is produced in the process of production of other products. So in case of byproduct, we have to value them at NRV. NRV means net realizable value deducted the NRV of these byproducts. Of any byproduct, the NRV of this byproduct is to be deducted from the joint cost. Similarly, in case of joint product, we have to compute two amounts, which is like we have to separate it between two amounts. First one being the sale value at point of separation, and the other one is sale value after the point of separation. So we have to do such calculation. You will get a better understanding when we will solve the question. Byproducts, these are measured at NRV, and this NRV is deducted from the joint cost. Now we will look into the other cost. So it is included if it is incurred in bringing the inventory to their present location and condition. So any cost which is incurred to bring the inventory to its present location or condition, it will be included as other cost, and it will form the part of the cost. The next one is exclusion from cost of inventories. So what all things are excluded from the cost of inventories? It's the abnormal cost, that is wasted material, labor or other production cost, any storage cost, unless those costs are necessary in the production process prior to the further production stage. So like in case of vines, we have to store them for a particular period, and for storage cost we have to add to the cost of inventory. Any other storage cost which is not necessary in the production process will not be included in the cost of inventories. Similarly, administrative overhead that do not contribute to bringing the inventories to their present location and or condition will not be included. Also, selling and distribution cost, which are but obviously not included in the cost of inventory. Next point is regarding the borrowing cost, usually considered as not relating to bringing the inventory to their present location and condition, and are therefore usually not included. So borrowing cost as such are not included in the cost of inventories. However, as per AS 16, for inventories that are qualifying assets, if any inventory is a qualifying asset, that is they take a substantial period of time to complete, then any directly attributable borrowing cost should be capitalized as a part of their cost. The next concept is regarding the cost formula. Specific identification is best wherever possible. So if you can identify, specifically identify, then it is best. Otherwise, in all other cases, first in, first out, that is the FIFO method, or the weighted average cost formula method must be utilized. The formula used should reflect the fairest possible approximation. So it should reflect the fairest possible approximation to the cost incurred in bringing the inventory to its present location or condition. So we have to look for the fairest possible approximation, whether it is FIFO or weighted average cost formula or any specific identification method. Other techniques of cost of measurement is standard cost, may be taken as cost of inventory provided and provide standards fairly approximate the actual. Standards so that should be regularly reviewed, and if necessary, it needs to be revised to reflect the current conditions. So one method is standard costing and the other one is the retail method. In retail business, units dealt by retailer, however, are usually sold for similar gross margin. So therefore, retail method, that is the cost of inventory, is determined by reducing the sale value of unsold stock by appropriate average percentage of gross margin. We will look a question where we will deal with both these concepts, then you will understand it in a much better way. The last point is regarding the disclosure requirements of AS2, which is the, we have to mention the accounting policy adopted in measuring the inventory, including the cost formula used. So which cost formula you are using, that is this, is it specifically identified or it is FIFO method or weighted average method, we have to mention that also. And we have to mention the total carrying amount of inventories together with an appropriate classification. As we have seen, there are three kinds of inventories. We have to mention that also. So now let us start with the PM questions of Accounting Standard 2. A private limited company manufacturing fancy terry towels had valued its closing inventory of finished products at at realizable value, inclusive of profit and export cash incentives. The firm contracts had been received and goods were packed for export, but the ownership in these goods had not been transferred to the foreign buyers. So, in this particular case, as we can see, there is a private limited company which is manufacturing fancy terry towels, and it is valuing closing inventory at net realizable value, which is inclusive of profit as well as export cash incentives. Also, the firm contracts has been received and goods are already packed for export, but ownership in these goods is not transferred to the foreign buyer. We have to comment on the valuation of inventory adopted by the company. So we can see that the valuation policy is not correct, but let us look into the answer first. AS2 valuation of inventory states that the inventory should be valued at lower of historical cost or net realizable value. AS9 on revenue recognition states at certain stages in specific industries, such as when agricultural crops have been harvested or mineral ores have been extracted, performance may be substantially complete prior to the execution of transaction generating revenue. In such cases, when sale is assured under forward contract or a government guarantee, or when market exists and there is a negligible risk of failure to sell, the goods invoiced are often valued at net realizable value. So what does this sentence say? It says that according to AS9, which is for revenue recognition, it states that in certain stages, in specific industries like agricultural crops where they have been harvested, or in mineral oils where they have been extracted, the performance, that is the transaction generating revenue, is substantially complete prior to actually transaction. Since you have extracted the mineral ore and you have harvested the agricultural crops, you are in a position to sell it, and there, but obviously, and there is very negligible risk that these products will not be sold and that they will not generate revenue. Because in such cases, the sale is assured either through forward contract or through government guarantee in case of export. And also when market exists, a ready market is available for the product and hence there is negligible risk of failure to sell. So the goods are invoiced, such goods are invoiced at net realizable value only. That is, in this case we don't follow this lower of cost or NRV. Airy towels do not fall in the category of agricultural products or mineral ores, but these terry towels are not falling in such category. That is, they are not in the specific industries. Accordingly, taking into the account the facts stated, the closing inventory of finished products, that is fancy terry towel, should have been valued at cost and NRV and not at NRV. Since they are already specifying that these are valued at NRV and which is inclusive of profit, and we know that cost plus profit could give us NRV, so cost is but obviously lower than the NRV. And in this terry towel, we have to follow that concept only, that we have to measure or value inventory at cost or NRV, whichever is lower. Further, export incentive are recorded only in year export takes place. So when is export incentive recorded? Only in the year in which export takes place. Therefore, the policy adopted by the company for valuing its closing inventories of finished product is not correct. Now let us move on to the next question. USL Limited purchased raw material at 400 rupee per kg. The company does not sell raw material but uses in production of finished goods. The finished goods in which raw material is used are expected to be sold at below cost. So we have already studied in the concept part that whenever the fixed goods is sold below the cost, then we have to value is sold below the cost, we have to value the raw material at replacement cost. At the end of the accounting year, company is having 10,000 kg of raw material in the inventory. As the company never sells the raw material, it does not know the selling price of the raw material, hence cannot calculate the NRV. At the end of the year, however, the replacement cost of the raw material is rupees 300 kg. How you will value the raw material? Inventory of raw material. So we know we have to value at the replacement cost, and in the question also we have been given the replacement cost only, so we will value it at this price only. Let us look into the answer first. As per para 24 of AS2 revised valuation of inventories, materials and other supplies held for use in production of inventories are not written down below cost if the finished products in which they will be incorporated are expected to be sold at or above cost. However, when there is a decline in the prices of materials and it is estimated that the cost of finished products will exceed the net realizable value, the materials are written down to the net realizable value. In such circumstances, the replacement cost of the may be the best estimate available to measure the NRV. Therefore, in this case, USA Limited will value the inventory of raw material at rupees 30 lakhs. How 30 lakhs? 10,000 kg at the rate of 300 per kg. So you don't have to write these all things. You just have to mention the concept part. You can mention this chart in your own words and you can write the answer. There is no need to write additional sentences like mentioned in this answer. So now move on to the next question. Knight Limited sells beer to the customer. Some of the customer consume the beer in the bars run by the Knight Limited. While leaving the bar, the consumer leaves the empty bottle in the bars and the company take possession of these empty bottles. The company has laid down a detailed internal record procedure for accounting for these empty bottles which are sold by the company by calling for tenders. Keeping this in view, decide whether the inventory of empty bottles is an asset. If so, whether the inventory of empty bottles existing as on the date of balance sheet is to be considered as inventory of the company and valued as per AS2, or it is to be treated as scrap and shown at net realizable value with corresponding credit to other income. So in this particular case, there is a company which is selling beers to the customer. Some customers consume beer and they leave it. But while leaving the bar, they leave the empty bottles in the bar itself. And the company takes possession of these empty bottles. And company has a detailed internal record procedure for accounting. That is, it is a material component. These empty bottles are a material component for the company. Hence, they are making a detailed internal record procedure for accounting of these empty bottles. And they are also calling for tenders. So, it is an asset. And valuation as per AS2 must be done. So let us look into the answer. Tangible objects or tangible rights carrying probable future benefits owned by the enterprise are called assets. So we have to first give the definition of assets. So assets are tangible objects or intangible right carrying probable future benefit, from which future benefit is probable and are owned by the enterprise, are regarded as assets. So, Knight Limited sells these empty bottles by calling tender. It means further benefits are accrued on its sale. Therefore, empty bottles are assets. Now, moving forward to the next part of the question. As per AS2 valuation of inventory, inventories are assets held for sale in the ordinary course of business. Inventory of empty bottle existing on the balance sheet date is the inventory, and Knight Limited has detailed control, recording and accounting procedure which duly signify its materiality. This we have already discussed. Hence, inventory of empty bottle cannot be considered as scrap, since they are of material, significant materiality. It cannot be considered as scrap and it must be valued as inventory only as per AS2. Considered as scrap. Now moving on to the next question, which is Anil Pharma Limited ordered 16,000 kg of certain material at rupees 160 per unit. The purchase price includes GST of rupees 10 per kg in respect of which full input tax credit is admissible. So we have to, since we know that any tax or duties which is recoverable or which has input tax credit, we have to deduct it. It is not included in the purchase price. Also, freight incurred amounted to ₹1,40,160. So we have to add this freight inward to this cost. The normal loss in transit is 2%. The company actually received 15,500 kg and consumed 13,600 kg. We have to compute the cost of inventory under AS2 as well as the amount of abnormal loss, if any. So, for computing the abnormal loss, what we will do? We had ordered 16,000 kg. From that, we have to subtract the 2% loss. The 2% loss is 320. But if we subtract it, we must have got 15,680. 15,680 of would be the normal after normal loss. But we have received only 15,500. So, we'll subtract 15,500. So the abnormal loss is of 180 kgs. Abnormal loss is 180 kg. So the abnormal loss will be 180 kg. And cost of inventory, how we will compute the closing inventory? Closing inventory will be the quantity which we have actually received. That is 15,500 subtract minus the already consumed. That is 13,600, which will give us the inventory of. The quantity will be 1900 kgs. So accordingly we will make the computations. Now let us look into the answer. First of all, we will consider the purchase price, which will be 16,000 into 160, which will give us 25,60,000. From that we will subtract this 10 kg of GST because we have the input tax credit. So 16,000 into 10, which will give us 1,60,000. See, this 1,60,000 will be deducted and then we will get the price 24 lakhs. In this we will add the freight charges, which is 1,40,160, and thus the total material cost will be 25,40,160. we have already computed the number of units of abnormal after normal loss, because 16,000 minus 2% was 15,680. This was the normal quantity after normal loss, but we have received only 15,500. But on this normal loss only, we will compute the revised cost per kg, because abnormal loss is not considered. So this material cost will not be divided by the quantity which we have received, but on the quantity which we must have received. So 25,40,160 will be divided by the number of units after normal loss only, and this will give us the revised cost per kg, that is 162. Now we will value the closing inventory. Material actually received, that is 15,500, minus the material consumed, which will give us 1900 kg. Now we will value the closing inventory, 1900 kg into 162, which will give 307,800. And abnormal loss would be this number of units after normal loss minus the material actually received, that is 15,500. So 180 will be the abnormal loss, and we will value abnormal loss in value. So 180 into this revised cost per kg, which is 162, and hence we will get the normal loss in value also. So now moving on to the second last question of ICI practice manual. This is an important question. You can mark it, you can give it a star mark. In a manufacturing process of Vijoy Limited, one byproduct DP emerges beside two main products, that is MP1 and MP2, apart from scrap. So in a company, there are actually four products which you have to account for. One is the MP1, which is the major product. Other one is MP2. The third one is scrap, and the fourth one is the byproduct. You have to do accounting of all these four. Detail of cost of production process is here under. Raw material used is given 1500 unit. Amount is given. Wages are given. Fixed overhead is given, as well as variable overhead is given. So we have to consider the fixed overhead is given for the entire quantity. We have to consider it at normal capacity or actual capacity. We will look into the question. Also, output is given for MP1, MP2 and byproduct, that is BP, and we have to value the closing inventory of MP1 and MP2. The average market price of MP1 and MP2 are 80 and 50 per unit respectively. Byproduct is sold at 25. There is a profit of 5,000 on sale of byproduct after incurring separate processing charges of rupees 4,000 and packaging charges of rupees 6,000. And rupees 6,000 was realized from sale of scrap. So as we can see, there were four products we have to consider in this. The two are the main product, one is the byproduct, and the other last one is the scrap. So for the byproduct, it is said that there is a profit of 5,000 on sale of byproduct after incurring processing charges of 4,000 and 6,000, and it is sold at 25 per unit, and the output is 1600. So we have to first, we will look into the calculation of byproduct, because the NRV of byproduct is to be reduced from the joint cost, as we have already seen in the concept part. If you want, I can show you for once. See, the byproduct NRV is deducted from the joint cost. We will do this step first. So for calculating NRV of byproduct BP, we will multiply the byproduct, that is selling price 25 into 1600. We will get the selling price. Then from that realizable value, from that we will subtract these selling charges, that is the 5000 plus 10,000 plus 6000. We will subtract it. So let us look into the solution first. As per para 10 of AS2 valuation of inventory, most byproducts as well as sale of scrap or waste materials by their nature are immaterial. Mostly are by the nature are immaterial. They are often measured at NRV, and this value is deducted from the cost of the main product. Okay, so the, from First we have to calculate their NRV, and then we have to subtract it from the cost of the main product. So first step would be the calculation of NRV of the byproduct BP. So how will it be computed? First we compute the selling price, which is 1600 units into 25, which will give us 40,000. From this we will subtract the separate processing charges of byproduct, which is 4,000, as well as the packaging charges of 6,000. So in net, 10,000 will be subtracted, and the net realizable value of the byproduct will be 30,000. This 30,000 will be deducted from the cost, joint cost of the product. See, NRV of the byproduct. This 30,000 is taken in this calculation. Also, the question says the sale value of scrap is 6,000. So all these figures we have already computed. Now we will look into the raw. The next step will be cost of conversion for allocation between the joint product. So how we will allocate the cost of conversion between the joint products, we have to consider that. So let us move on to the values given in the question. All these values you have to consider, because these are the cost: raw material plus wages plus overhead plus variable overhead. So we'll just add all these costs, which will give us 3,40,000. From this we have to subtract two things, that is NRV of byproduct as well as the sale value of scrap. NRV will be considered from the first step, that is 30,000. This 30,000 is taken here, and 6,000 is given in question. We will subtract these, and this is the joint cost which needs to be allocated between the two products, main products MP1 and MP2. This 3,04,000. So now we will consider or determine the basis of allocation for the cost. So we have been given the output in units, which is 620 and 5,000 for MP. This is given in the question. Also selling price is given, which is 80 and 50. Then we will compute the sale value, that is 5 lakh and 250. So we will, the basis of allocation for joint cost would be on the basis of sales value, which is 5 lakh and 250, that is the ratio will be 2:1. So this joint cost of 3,04,000 will be allocated in the ratio of 2:1 between MP1 and MP2. Hence we will get the joint cost allocation, and then we will divide it by the number of units, that is the output, that is C. This C figure is divided by the number of units or output, which will give the cost per unit. You can go through this calculation once more, or you can practice it for better understanding. So now we will value the closing inventory, that is we will consider these two costs, MP1 and MP2, 343 and 20.27, which is calculated, which is taken from the previous calculation.